I've mentioned this before, but perhaps to those who are just joining us, and another who's just joining us. So if you came to this session last year, not so much has changed. So it is quite similar to what I said last year. So before I make people sit through, you know, another hour of talking about Civi's accounting that I forced them to sit through last year. Yes. So I have pre-warned you. Cool. Okay. And the other point about this is that I haven't had a huge amount of time to refresh my memory of the slides. So at certain points, I may need to read it twice to remind myself exactly what I was talking about. But I did change the front slide to say 2016. So I'm quietly pleased about that as a step forward. Yes. So we're well on the way. Cool. Right. Okay. Accounting in CiviCRM. Let's see what we have. So this is going to be as much as a surprise as to you guys as it is to me as it is to you guys. Cool. Okay. So just to introduce myself, my name is Jamie Novick. I'm the director of Compucorp. We're a digital agency specializing in working with open source platforms. We work primarily with CiviCRM and Drupal. So I'd say about 70% of what we do is kind of CiviCRM and integrated Drupal sites. We're partners, we're CiviCRM partners, and we work very closely with the core team on a number of different kind of projects. And actually, one of the pieces that I'm going to talk about a little bit later is one of those from a little while ago. Some of the people that we've been lucky enough to work with. So, range of organisations, some big, some small. Cool. Right, formalities over. Okay, so an overview, understanding accounting in Civi. So all of this stuff, kind of the first part of the presentation is, you know, all the stuff that came into CiviCRM once it started to understand accounting. So that's like version 4.3 plus. We're now 4.6, moving on to 4.7. So all of that stuff's, you know, very heavily embedded in there. I'm just going to mention, I mean, there was some work that was done specifically for 4.6, which is now obviously core as well, so that people know about that. That came in more recently. Perhaps when I made these slides, you know, that was slightly more recent that was happening. And then I'm just going to talk about like some other options as well. So other things that you can do around CiviCRM, talk about very briefly Civi banking, also integration with third-party accounting systems and things like that. Okay. And what normally helps with this is, because I have to remind myself a little bit about the accounting, I was formerly a qualified accountant and then got out of that to this. But sometimes I have to remember the accounting. Do correct me if I do anything wrong, number one. And number two, if anybody has any questions about anything, then just stick your hand up and we'll go through it. It's a workshop. Cool. Okay, understanding accounting in Civi. Yes, these things. Okay, defining integration. Okay, so how does Civi, what's the big picture here? So you've probably got kind of, your CRM system, which is managing your sales process to a certain extent. So CiviCRM may be taking events tickets, it may be taking donations, it may have memberships, payments that are coming in. Civi's kind of, dealing with a lot of financial transactions. Now, then you have your big bad accounting system at the back of kind of your organization. And your accounting system basically needs to do more than just the sales side. So your accounting system will need to understand both the incomes, but also the expenses that are kind of all coming out, but also needs to have an idea of the position of the organization. So maybe things like the amounts that you're owed, and also obviously the amounts that you owe to other people. So Civi, you know, kind of fits in or bolts on as kind of one small part of the information that needs to be provided to your accounting system. And the key to making any CRM, you know, work well with a third-party accounting system is creating a well-defined method of integrating between the two. So what does that integration look like for CiviCRM? Well, the idea within CiviCRM is that whatever goes on in your kind of sales cycle through CiviCRM, you're able to export that data in a controlled way, and I'll explain what that means, into your accounts package. And so I just mentioned that this is not, CiviCRM doesn't out the box integrate electronically to, you know, all of these other packages. There are extensions, and obviously you can work with development houses in order to do further integrations if you'd like to. But Civi has out the box this controlled method of being able to export out the correct data into your accounts package. Okay, so, originally, I mean, this work started was done maybe about 3 or 4 years ago, and QuickBooks was designed as the primary integration. So the format for that export is kind of QuickBooks, but there's also a CSV export, which you can use for pretty much any accounting package that you would like. Okay. So we don't need to touch on this so much. This is probably a little bit old, but we have a concept called financial types. And we have now financial accounts and a feature for batch outputting this data. Okay, and so this allows you to categorize, you know, your income to particular financial accounts. This will all make sense in the not too distant future when I actually show it, he says. Which should lead you to having more confidence in your financial reporting because you're able to export things out in a controlled way. Okay, let's have something real here in the slides. Financial types. Okay, let's dive into actually looking at Civi, I think. Unless I... Okay, fundraising is fully customizable, yeah. Okay. Okay, so this is actually a bit more relevant, sorry. So in CiviCRM, what will be happening is that financial transactions will be coming into CiviCRM. So as I said, that, you know, some of the examples might be membership, there might be events, might be different types of events, might be donations. And every transaction is assigned a financial type. So what do we mean about that? So let's just take a quick look in Civi. Hands up here, who's new to CiviCRM? This is the first one. So we've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So out this side. All right, so I'll explain a little bit more from the basis. So Civi has a concept which is called contributions. Contributions are a record of a financial transaction within CiviCRM, hence contribution. The naming contribution, it could be donation, but they're called contributions because some organizations might recognize them not as a financial transaction as well, so it can be non-financial. So if we record, let's say that this person, Junko Adams, made a contribution, you can see that we've got a field at the top here, which is the financial type of the contribution. And so when we say this, we're saying, okay, campaign contribution, donation, event fee, membership due, we're categorizing this financial transaction in some way. And we're kind of telling Civi, okay, right, this is a certain category of financial transaction that's coming it through. Now, if we wanted to take a, so I'll just save that one. Yeah, that should be enough. No, this person's deceased, not ideal. It's all right, if you can get money from the, yeah, anyway. So let's try Kiara. So let's say Kara signs up for a membership. And here in CiviCRM, so I'm recording a membership, which organization it's attached to, how long it's going to be, blah, 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 blah. And here I click record membership payment, yes. And here again, I can put it in. And Civi's actually defaulted this to be a membership due. And again, I said I've received that. So now I've recorded two transactions and categorized them slightly differently. I've said that one's a donation and that one is a membership due. Now, CiviCRM has some clever stuff at the back, which I'm going to talk through here, which is the financial types. So each of these financial types is connected to particular accounts within CiviCRM under the hood. And so this is where it starts to get a little bit more complicated. So the donation here, if I click and say which accounts is this one connected to, it's saying, okay, income from a donation is going to this donation account with an accounting code of 4200, which is a revenue account. And so what Civi's done for anything which was a donation, it said, okay, the income is going to be recorded against the financial account, which is this 4200. So you guys will probably have in your accounting system a list of income accounting codes or revenue accounting codes, and Civi has recorded that there. Now, we'll ignore the rest of these for a second. But you're able to set up any number of these financial types as you need. So if, let's say, I wanted to categorize some payments to a different accounting code, I can set up more financial types. And that will add to that list that I can then see on the contribution when I do a new contribution. So anytime I add a financial type, it will come and be available here as one of the options that we can select when we're recording a payment. Okay, that's great. And you can see that when I put this financial type in, so if I say conference events, great, so we've got conference events. In the accounts here, you can see that it's automatically created me a new income account called conference events. So Civi's kind of assumed that because I've created a new financial type, probably the revenue account is going to be a new one as well. So I can then go into my financial accounts in Civi. And here is where I can edit all of the actual accounts that Civi is recording kind of financial transactions to. So at the moment, I'm just looking at revenue accounts, but this will, you know, have more to do with accounts receivable and things like that. But so here I've put in, where is my conference events? And I could say, you know, this is for conference events, great. And I could say maybe in my account system that this is, what was events, 4300, so maybe this is 4310. And what you would want to do is to map these accounts and therefore your financial types to the income accounts that you would have in your accounting system. So that when you come to do your import, or your export from CiviCRM, that data can go directly into your account system, which is what we will come to in a moment. Okay, so that is financial types. So, and that is financial accounts. Okay, so let me explain a little bit more.
Sorry, can I ask a question?
Yes.
So if I understand it right, what you define in accounts, no types, is how the booking is done from a financial transaction. Is that right?
Yes, exactly, yeah.
You know, normally when you do it in your accounting system, mm-hmm. you do a debit and a credit.
Mm-hmm.
Transaction.
I'm about to get to all of that. Yes, that's cool. So I just wanted to kind of introduce the concept of those financial types and the contributions. So there's five primary account types in CiviCRM and how it kind of captures, encapsulates kind of accounting. So there are revenue accounts. So revenue accounts, which is that, okay, what we saw there was a sale and, you know, the debit, let me get this right. No, the credit will be the revenue. The assets, which will be, okay, we've actually received the cash or the receivable that we're owed. A liability, if we actually owe money elsewhere, so I think that comes into the sales taxes, expenses and cost of sales. So Civi kind of maps with all of that. And each financial type that we would see there is mapped to one of these. So I showed you the relationship there to the revenue account, but as you saw on the screen, there's also a mapping to which asset account, expense account, and which accounts receivable that each of these financial types should go into. Okay. Okay, so let's try and take a real example and kind of play this through. Okay, so if we were taking a pending membership, so hopefully everybody's kind of familiar with the idea that within CiviCRM, you're able to have things which are paid for later. So the idea here is that, let's say that people want to buy their conference tickets now, they should get the ticket, but they're not actually going to pay. They're not actually going to pay for it. There's an option within the contribution pages for you to pay for it later. So within, you know, kind of normal accounting, let's take the example of the membership. That's better. So somebody pays for their membership, they receive the renewal, but they're going to receive an invoice or get and pay for that later. We would credit the income, so the membership account, which is 100. And we would debit the accounts receivable, also 100. So if we just do that in CiviCRM, so we do membership, new membership, I'm going to say, pick somebody who's not deceased this time. And I'm recording the payment at the same time, but I'm going to set this payment and say that its status is pending. So one thing to say is that CiviCRM loves a status field. So like the status fields in Civi, especially for the contributions and membership, are super important. They do lots of stuff in the back end, but it's this little field at the bottom that you need to make sure that you pay very close attention to. So if we save that pending membership, so we can see that I've confused myself, but I think it's this organizational membership that we had here. So what Civi will have done in the back end is recorded our pending membership, the revenue to the credit income to the membership account and the receivable to the accounts receivable. And what we're able to do, and let's say that this is the position at the end of the month, you're able to export that data out of Civi as it stands. So those accounting entries, you're actually able to export them out. And how do we do that? Well, we go to this section here, which says accounting batches, and we open up a new batch. So what do we mean by a batch? The idea of a batch or the batch export in Civi is the fact that you can't export out your transactions more than once. So that you take a set of transactions, let's say that we've got these debits, these credits, these debits, these credits, these have all gone into Civi, these have gone into the back end. Right, we want to export these out because we want to put them into our accounting system once in order to make sure that the accounting system then has the same transactions recorded in it. So we've recorded the same credits and debits that have kind of come out of Civi into our accounting system. So once you've batched a series of transactions, those ones are kind of locked and can't be added to another batch in future. And so this is the aspect of kind of controlled export, of being able to control and make sure that we get the transactions out of CiviCRM but never double count them when we then import them into our accounting system. So I'm seeing some nods, so hopefully that makes a bit of sense. So here we can see that these transactions that I just made have popped up as available transactions. I'm just going to take this one transaction. And so in terms of the structure of this, you can see that I'm looking at this. I've opened a new batch. It's telling me kind of the total, the date that it was opened, how many transactions have been added, so none yet, who did it. I'm going to select a transaction here, which is the Rebecca Adams one. I'm going to go to actions, and I'm going to say assign to batch. Awesome, right? So it's updated, it said assigned transactions one, total is 100. So what I've done here is that those debits and credits that were attached to this particular transaction, I've now added them to this batch. So when I close and export this batch, the debits and credits, i.e. Credit, income, debit, receivable, will be locked and can't then be exported again. So once they're exported, then you can give them to your accountant and say, hey, end of the month, this is what the change in position, you know, from the CRM was. You can import that in as your debits and credits, and then they can do a bank rec in order to say, okay, right, the account system, you know, is up to date, so everything adds up. So here I'm going to go to close and export batch. I mentioned before that it gives you kind of these two options. So the first option is the format for imports to QuickBooks, and the second format is the CSV. I'm just going to use the CSV. Secure. Download. Take a little look at that. Go away. Okay. And here you can see that it's giving me all of that information. So I've got, for this one transaction, you can see the, hang on, nobody can see that because it's too small. The transaction date, the debit account that the debits were going to, so accounts receivable, the amount, which was 100. And then we've also got on the other side, just telling me a few more details, we've got the credits and the fact that that went to an income account and which income account that was. So we've managed to export out the actual accounting entries that are attached to that single transaction that happened in Civi. So Civi's made the accounting entries, you know, kind of for us. Okay, so that's great news. So what happens next? Da-da-da. Okay, so what will happen next, probably in a normal workflow, is that you'll actually receive the payment for this. So from a CiviCRM perspective, that might be that, you know, the check's been received in the post, or, you know, the bank has turned up, so you know, you can see in the bank that the cash has been paid, and so that pending contribution that you had before can now be turned into. So if I do search. Let's just not find people. Go away. Whoops. Sorry. Fine contributions. So if I look at the pending contributions, there we go. Great. So I can see this pending contributions. And I can see that actually this is the financial transaction behind it. I can go and edit this contribution and say, well, actually now we've received the money, so I'm marking this as completed, and then I'm going to click save. Great. And actually, one thing for those who aren't aware, that will update, was it Rebecca Adams? Membership also to make the organizational membership like current, so like it will update the status for that because you've now received the payment. It does the same with events as well. If we now go to do our accounting batch and do a new batch, so the other one is closed, if we just save this and we have a look, we can see that that completed payment now is there, so let's assign that one to the batch. And if I close and export this batch now, CSV, thank you. Desktop, thank you. You can see that now the debit side of the transaction, which if we remember here, so what happened, sorry, I should have explained the accounting first. So when you receive the payment, what would you expect the accounting to be? Well, you would credit the accounts receivable because you're reducing the, if anybody remembers accounting, it's dead click. So you credit accounts receivable because you're taking an asset, reducing your asset of the class asset receivable, and you're giving yourself an asset which is cash instead because you've actually got the cash now. So Civi has done those for you, and it's put debit accounts, debit your bank, so you've increased your asset of the bank, and credit your accounts receivable there as well on the other side. So that way it's kind of, people looking at me? No, nobody's following the accounting bit at the back, are they? No, okay, good. We can chat about that later and explain. So basically, this is the bit when, you know, when your accountant kind of does all that funny stuff. Yeah, that's, yeah, yeah. All you have to do is do the export bit. I'm just kind of showing for the people who care whether it adds up. So, you know, that's fine. So a lot of work went into making it add up. Let's put it that way. So Civi will do the accounting entries for you. The different accounting codes, so hopefully that's starting to make a little bit more sense then. So you're able to, in the configuration of your financial types, therefore, define, define exactly when I have a pending contribution, where should the accounts receivable go to? So I'm saying, okay, so it should go to this account, which just happens to be a general accounts receivable. But it might be that an accounts receivable for a membership transaction should go into a different account, because that's how your, you know, your accounts are set up. Similarly, the same for your income, as we said before, that can go elsewhere. And also the asset, which you can assign as well. So if we want to add that one, we can add in the other one. Asset account is deposit bank account, I think it's going to say. Okay. I've done something wrong. Okay, fine. Okay. So let's do the next bit. Okay. Yeah, that's not so relevant anymore. We can skip through that. Okay, and we've shown the accounting batches, which allow you to export, and each transaction may only be exported once, which gives you the control. So you can export in that way. So one little note to make for developers is that at the moment, the accounting batch has a certain set of fields. There is a hook there that you can add extra fields in there as well. So if you want to get more information out of your accounting batch because you need more for your accountant, then you are able to extend that.
Cool.
Mm-hmm. Create a batch. Oh, I've skipped through some of these slides, sorry. Okay, so one of the other things that is also worth mentioning, but something which is a little bit of a side point, is that there's also a bookkeeping transactions report. So I'll just explain kind of like a little bit the difference between this and the accounting batches. So the bookkeeping transactions report gives you some very similar information that you can see here. And some people, when they're starting off with Civi, might think, oh, okay, well, this does the job of all the information that I'm going to need for my accountant. And in some ways it might, but the point of having the batch is so that you ensure that you don't double count the transactions that you are providing to your accountant. So if, for example, you were to go and record a contribution from last month in the system, this would end up, if we've got this in date order, this will end up like further down the list. So if you're just sending this report off to your accountant, and you say, well, I've done it up to October, you know, 1st, that transaction which ends up down the list will not get sent to him when you do everything that's come in after October 1st, even though that transaction hasn't been sent to your accountant. So therefore, your accounts won't reconcile. So this is kind of for reference only, so knowing what's actually in your CiviCRM and being able to see kind of what Civi's processed and kind of where it is. But the accounting batch system is how you should be getting out your data if you're exporting that then for your accountants. Okay. Boom, boom, boom. Cool. Okay, the new bit. This is going to bend my brain a little bit, so I need to remember exactly how this works. So as of Civi 4.6, a lot of work was done around two things. So number one was giving CiviCRM support for sales taxes, so VAT basically, so charging VAT on transactions, and also for support for Civi being able to send out legal VAT invoices, so actually invoices. So before you could have somebody pay later, but Civi isn't necessarily going to create a uniquely numbered sequential invoice, which is one of the requirements that you need to have for invoicing, so VAT invoicing, and showing the correct details on that invoice about the breakdown for VAT and all of those kind of things. So that's all there in 4.6. It's optional, you can switch it on and off. So you don't have to use this, you don't have to have sales tax, you don't have to have invoicing. So if you've got an account system and you like sending out invoices from that, you don't have to use this with Civi. You can switch it on and you know, obviously talking to your accountant about how you want to set these things up, but it can sit alongside your invoicing from your existing account system. The numbering for both can be sequentials, but they could have a different prefix, for example, for the ones that are coming out from your main account system as to the ones that are coming out of CiviCRM. So if you need to have that discussion with them, then that's fine as well. So, for example, there may be certain types of sales that your organization does that, you know, you do from your main accounting system because they don't need to touch Civi. Whereas Civi, let's say, does all your events and membership, and so you could have the invoicing coming directly out of Civi and email to people when they buy things online. Okay, how does it work? I need to remember all of this, so bear with me. Sales taxes. Okay, so what does it do? So it will show the sales tax amount. Have I got a slide that actually does that? No, I'm going to have to do that. It shows the sales tax amount on the event registration, membership sign-up forms. Actually, there's an integration with web forms of CiviCRM if anybody uses that for payments. Configurable display options, and then it processes the sales tax based on the rules that you give it. And there's support for percentage-based taxes so far. So there was some, and a single percentage base. So in the UK and most of the EU, as far as I know, we generally just have one single percentage, aka VAT at 20% or 5% or whatever it may be. You know, in some districts in the US, for example, you'll have two levels of taxation. Civi doesn't quite support that, but it is possible to develop it in order to do that. And yeah, integration with Webform Civi CRM as well, so if you're using that quite heavily, which we do generally. Okay, so I actually want to show it, and I'm wondering whether or not the best thing is to do it in here. So let's just do this. Okay, so I am going to go into Civi Contribute. I'm going to take one of my financial, not financial accounts, I'm going to take one of my financial types. And I'm going to say for event fees, under the accounts, I'm going to assign an account here. The financial relationship is going to be sales tax account is, and I need to create sales tax account first. Sorry, bear with me. Wrong way around. Financial account. Okay, add financial account. So I'm going to create a financial account. So I'm going to say this is the VAT, if I can remember rightly, if this is the creditor, I think this is the creditor account. Boom, boom, boom. I'm going to say that this is the liability account. Give it an accounting code, 1200. Don't need a tax code. Is tax? Yes. And I'm going to say that this is just a very simple one, which is 20%. Okay, save. Yep, it seems to be okay with that. And now I'm going to go Civi Contribute, and I'm going to add, back to my financial types, and I'm going to go to event fee, and I'm going to assign an account, which is the sales tax account now, and I'm going to say the VAT creditor account is that one. And what Civi is going to do is it's going to take that 20% that I entered in about the financial financial account, and it's going to use that as the VAT add-on processing bit for any contributions which are for this financial type. So let's just do that. Let's just check everything's switched on. Payment. So I've enabled tax and invoicing here. So this is, sorry, this is one of the big buttons that you need to do first. So enable tax and invoicing. By default, this is switched off. And this is under the administer Civi Contribute and Civi Contribute component settings. And here you'll see all the different the settings. So invoice prefix, credit node prefix, due date, and some other details, and any standard terms that go on the invoice. And here you can also set how sales taxes should be displayed online. So depending on how you, different jurisdictions, there's different kind of rules about how you want this shown. So you can have it, don't show the breakdown, only showing the total, like 120. If it's 100, this one, show tax term, inclusive price. So 120 includes tax term. And here under tax term, you can say what the tax is. So for the UK, you know, EU be VAT, but elsewhere it could be GST. I don't know, I'm making up letters now. Yeah.
BGW
sounds great. And then deciding kind of how it looks. So I'm going to go with that one. That seems very sensible. Cool. Right. Now, if I have an event, let's take an event or a membership or whatever it may be, in all places in Civi that use the event contribution type. So let's see if this. Fees. Yes, excellent. So this one's event fee, And let's just make something very simple, which is, you know, ticket, and we're just going to have one price, and let's say it's $100. Very strange collecting VAT on dollars. Let's just do only this. No, let's do continue. Awesome. Moment of truth, event info.
I think you need to change the date in order to register.
Oh, right, okay. When? October 3rd. Yeah, that's going to be difficult. And I also need to switch off the cart as well. Do that. Just going to switch off Civi event. For those who don't know, there's like a cart that you can switch on with Civi event. Okay, let's try this again. Ta-da! Right, okay, so conference fee. You can see that CiviCRM has automatically taken my £100 ticket fee and it's added 20% VAT because we've told it to. So if I now go in through and register now, blah, 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 and I'm gonna say, yeah, ticket, and get my, hopefully this will be fine. Yep, that's me. No thanks. Continue. Yes, excellent. Warning message, but that looks good. Okay, so now I've done an event registration. So if I go to Novick, which one? could be anyone. Okay, yeah, there we go, that'll be. So you can see that the amount was 120, but if we take a look at this, you'll see that it's given us the breakdown here, which is the conference fee, 100 for the unit price, subtotal, VAT rate 20%, tax amount 20, and 120. So it's given us kind of like all of that breakdown, kind of information. And you should see, I think, the same on here. Oh, it's taken a credit card fee as well. So we've got total amount, tax amount, and I'm not sure if it does the amount without the tax because that's the amount that we've actually received. So that sounds about right. Cool. So now, if we go to our accounting batches, hopefully, new batch, 120, chances of this working. We're very close. This is so close, come on. And if we do our accounting batch, I feel like I need a drum roll for this. Woohoo. Cool, right. So you can see, and the way that CiviCRM deals with it is that you have the main transaction, which is you can't actually see all the columns here, but trust me, it makes sense. You've got debit amount when it's split of 100, and you've got the credit amount of 100 when it's split, and then you've got 20, which is the other side of the transaction. Civi also gives you this unsplit amount, which is kind of like a bit of a hangover from before, but you can basically ignore that if you're really doing your accounting, depending on how you actually add up your numbers. But you can see that 120 was the debit amount received, and then we've got the other side of things, which is the event fee and the VAT creditor account, which is the VAT amount going in there as well. So you can have, the way that this is kind of set up is that you can have different VAT amounts, or VAT rates for different elements in the system. So for example, if you have event fees which are 20%, but let's say that membership happens to be at 5% for whatever reason, then by setting up different VAT accounts, you can then join them to financial transactions separately and therefore have different rates for the different financial types within CiviCRM. Now, you are able to, I mean, we generally advise clients, there is kind of one complication that clients have where, let's say for membership, sometimes membership tends to have a VATable portion and sometimes a donation portion. So that's kind of quite a common thing that happens. So one of the simpler ways of dealing with that within CiviCRM is to work out what your composite rate is for the two of those. Let's say that it's, you know, 16% because your membership of, I'm not going to be able to do the maths in my head here, let's say your £20 membership was £15 was donation and £5 was VATable, and then the £5 VATable therefore, you know, would collect £2 of VAT. No, what's 20% of five will be £1. So 1/20th, which will be 5%. So therefore you would put 5% in, even though it was a 20% on the five. Trust me, that number was right. But you can put in those composite rates and put an explanation actually on the invoice. The invoice, okay, so I just did a transaction online. I don't think this was set up for that, but we can do invoices a different way. So, oh, let's see, I probably got a slide, so I don't want to say the slides after. So sales tax liability. Oh, yeah, all the stuff that I just showed you. 20, 100, 120. So credit income, and then you have the tax creditor and the debit accounts receivable. So what you saw in Civi was that this 120, it does it separately. So it does 100 and 100 and 20 and 20, and that's why you have the two lines. Obviously, it will deal with the if you do pending first, you get the sales tax recognised on the revenue, and then you will get the completed amount after you complete the transaction. It even shows me how to configure it. That would be really useful. I'll share the slides afterwards if anybody would like them, so you can put that in. Sales count is great. Okay, so the legal VAT invoices. So you can set up the VAT invoices from Civi. So if you switch this on, they're automatically emailed as an attached PDF when somebody purchases things online. Admin can download from the admin interface as well, and admin can email, and you can even do it in bulk as a search action. If I go here and I take a look at this Jamie Novick record and I look at the contribution, because I've enabled the invoicing, I've got these extra buttons, print invoice and email invoice. So if I do print invoice, let's see what this comes up with. Cool. We have our invoice here, and you can see that it will have given it an invoice number. So it's taken the prefix that I told Civi to take and put an invoice number here, and it's kind of, you know, done all this kind of configuration here. If the invoice is unpaid, then it'll do the calculation for us, and so on and so forth, and then you have this little bit at the bottom. So if you want to email that directly, you can email it and you can say, okay, from such and such, put a little text at the top, and then it will automatically attach the invoice to the email if you want to send that to somebody. If you want to do that in bulk, there's also a search action. No, don't do it like that, Jamie. Let's do find contribution. So obviously it's from the contribution. You do find contributions. Let's invoice these two people. Invoices, print or email. So let's say I want to email the invoice, and then I can select to email it, or if I want to print multiple invoices because I'm going to do a batch run, then I can do all of those in a big batch and not have to click through every single one. So you can tweak the look and feel of that invoice. It is a message template, and it is one of the system workflow ones. And
fourth one from the top,
contributions invoice, brilliant. So if you go in and edit this, I'll be honest, it's a lot of HTML code, but if you feel confident kind of doing that, then you can drop it into your HTML editor and play around with the different elements on there. Replacing the logo is quite easy actually, so you can kind of just take it from there and just replace that little line there. Cool, right. Okay. One other feature. So, if I can remember, this is CiviCRM/user, I think. Yes. So, if anybody uses the contact dashboard, so this is like a public page in CiviCRM that's by default provided by CiviCRM. So This is like a page that when a user logs in, you could put a little link, which is, you know, to my dashboard. So if you're like a membership organization or events organization, once a supporter of your organization, so they wouldn't have to have access to CiviCRM in order to see this page. This is like a public page. And this gives them information about all the stuff that they've made payments for. And this actually has the ability or a button that is to print their invoices directly from here. So you could have a workflow which is a bit like the shopping cart. You know, they buy it online, it sends them an invoice. If they need to download their latest invoice, they can go and get it from here. These will be updated. So if you mark a contribution as a paid from being pending, it updates the invoice for them. So they've got the receipt in effect, or the completed invoice, or the receipted invoice. I've heard people call it as well. So you can get that directly from there as well. Just to show that, yeah, so we got the same invoice, great. So that's all there as well. Okay, so I'll touch on this briefly. There's also credit notes and refunds. So if you have an existing contribution here and it's completed, but you want to say, well, actually, no, we had to refund this for whatever reason, I would go and change the status, and I would say, okay, actually, this is refunded. When was it refunded? And put all of that stuff in. And this, error. Oh, we were doing so well. I broke it. Okay, let's see if that contribution did get marked as a refund. Yes, it did. Okay, let's see what we're going to get from this. No, we've killed it. Okay, don't try this at home, kids. My slightly old version of Civi would give you a... Let's see if we can do it in 4.6. Hang on. Trying a laptop. Contributions. Have I got invoicing switched on? No, I haven't. Hang on. I would say talk amongst yourselves. View. Cool. So I'm just going to edit that. I'm going to mark this as refunded. Go for it. Yes. So there you go. Now we're printing invoice and credit note. So I wasn't sure if we'd actually received the money for this invoice, but if we had. And so here you'll see that you've got this invoice less the amount credited because they hadn't paid for it at this time, and then the credit note here as well. So the matching kind of document between it. So you've got kind of support for both sides of things. Cool. Okay, so configuration, all right, modify the template. Right, last bit. So there's two things that are kind of coming up with CiviCRM, or exist that are also of note. Xero is an account package, which I think, you know, quite a lot of small organizations use. We've got a lot of familiarity with that. There is a third-party extension developed, I think, by Fusion, which is worth checking out. So that integrates kind of Civi with their invoicing. So if you purchase something, if a contribution is created in Civi, rather than Civi generating the invoice, you can get it generated directly in Xero. So it's worth taking a look at that. And I think it goes both ways, which is if you mark an invoice as paid in Xero, it will update the contribution back in Civi as well. So that's quite cool if you already use Xero. And one thing which is on the horizon, which is kind of getting worked on, which I was hoping might be available for this year, but not quite there yet, is around accruals accounting. So hands up who actually knows what I mean when I'm talking about accruals accounting. Okay, four people. Right, so let me explain what this is gonna be. Okay, so if you were to sell, let's do an event. If you were to sell the tickets for an event today, And let's assume that you actually received the money for that ticket today. So let's say we sold a ticket for an event today of £100 and received it. But the event's not going to take place until the end of the year. Let's say it's not taking place until the 1st of January 2017. That money that you've received shouldn't actually be recognised as revenue that you've received yet. Actually, that is deferred income. So it's actually money that you've received, but if the event doesn't take place, the way that accounting rules work is that actually, well, you wouldn't get to recognise that as revenue because you haven't really earned it because the event didn't take place, you've got to give that back. So the accountants would want to defer the revenue for that. Now, the same is true actually for memberships as well. So a slightly more complicated example is if you have a membership that, let's say that your membership starts on the 1st of January 2016, but it runs until 31st of December 2016, but your accounting period went from 1st of April 2016 until 31st of March 2017. Yep, follow the things. If you sold the membership, let's say, for £120, on the 1st of January, but there's only 3 months of that year, they're only going to get 3 months worth of benefit of that membership that year. It wouldn't be correct to recognise the revenue fully of £120 in that year. So accounts would say, okay, well, actually what you need to do is you need to defer the £90, the other 9 months of the year, to next year and have that as deferred income, which would then get released probably every month in the future. So that's accruals accounting. So at the moment, Civi doesn't quite support that. So once you export this data out, if you've received the revenue, if you've received the money, Civi kind of assumes that you've received it and therefore you recognize the revenue, which is called cash accounting. But there's work afoot to get Civi so you can switch a toggle which kind of says, okay, well, actually we want accruals accounting which would defer the revenue that you've received. I've lost absolutely everybody at this point, haven't I? Cool. Okay, good. Okay. Any questions? Oh dear. Okay, so look, shall we start at the front and we'll work our way backwards? Cool.
Yeah, I was just wondering, how about partial payments? Will it work just the same, also with the exporting and stuff?
Very good point. Okay, so partial payments works, as far as I know, a little thing, but all of that works with all the accounting. What I would say is that there's probably a few quirks with partial payments with invoicing. So I'm not sure if the invoicing has been updated to support the partial payments.
I think it is,
okay.
So
with the invoicing, with having the, I would check that with partial payments. Okay.
But the exporting.
Yeah. Yeah, that's all been designed with it in mind. Yeah.
Oh, nice.
Okay. Cool. Yeah.
How does Civi handle pledges?
Pledges.
Yes.
Right. Okay. So this is a big topic of discussion, one that has been discussed many times. How Civi should handle pledges. I have a personal view. Others might have a different view. But a pledge. In some senses, from an accounting point of view, could be considered to be a non-financial transaction. So actually, the pledge has nothing to do with accounting. So you would kind of say, well, I've pledged to pay you. That doesn't mean I should recognize income on this. That doesn't mean you're a debtor. Accounting revenue, so the rules around recognizing revenue for accounting, you know, there are particular rules around that which your accountant would advise as being appropriate. Civi, in terms of the way that it deals with pledges, is kind of the same. It's saying that the pledge is a non-financial, you know, entity transaction. It's a thing. We've had a discussion. I said that I'm going to give it to you. I might not. So we don't actually recognise anything until you make the contribution. So if you want to recognise the revenue, but you haven't received the money yet, i.e. I've invoiced you, or we've made a contract and you're going to pay me, then you would create a contribution. So the contribution, in a way, is like the order entity. So it's kind of like, okay, I've received an order, we've contracted, and I'm owed that money, and I would set the senators to be pending. Hopefully that made some sense.
Yeah.
Yes.
In the long term, you've got an issue really with accounts receivable because you maybe have to reconcile who it is who hasn't paid you.
Yes.
And it seems to me that in the long term, Civi should be looking at exporting a contact internal ID with perhaps a DR or something as the account reference that goes into the accounting system so that you're updating individual contact debtors.
So this was again another bone of contention. So the batch export, the idea, you know, kind of behind it is that, okay, what's the total amount of revenue, and I can plop that in my account system, right? So not the individual transactions themselves and matching those. So the idea is the individual transactions are held in Civi. Why do we want to duplicate those? Now, you can enhance that export, and we've done that before to clients, to add in those fields. So that's when I mentioned that you can get a developer to kind of do some extra. Would be nice if it was a couple of clicks, welcome contributions in order to get there. But it can be done that each of those transactions can have the information about the exact person, so that if you've got the appropriate import in your system, it can create the invoices for you in the account system and do all that reconciling for you. It is possible to kind of do that, but I think a decision was made previously that wasn't the idea of how they wanted Civi's integration to work. The other thing I would say is that it's quite easy to get to a debtor's ledger in Civi, which is just searching for pending contributions.
Yeah.
Sorry for my bad English. I have a problem with splitting the contribution, because in some case I have a contribution with one selling of a book, a donation, and so I have to create three or four contributions with one.
Okay, so you've hit the complicated nail on the head. I wish I had a whiteboard. So you can set up, or hopefully people will be aware, but I was trying to avoid this, something called price sets. And a price set within CiviCRM is, the best way to explain it is that each field within the price set is like a line item on an invoice. And if you imagine that you're raising an invoice for, you know, somebody, the invoice will have on it, you know, line item 1, 2, 3, 4, and each line on the invoice will probably have an accounting code that it goes to. So if you set up your price set for each of those fields to have a separate financial type, then they will have the separate accounting applied to each line. So you can do things at the contribution level. That's the really simplistic way of doing things. You can actually do things at the line item level by using price sets. And, you know, the long-term direction is to kind of move away from the contribution living as an entity on its own. And Eileen will correct me potentially, which is that I think even if you create a contribution, actually in the back end, each of those has one line item attached to it. So the way to kind of visualize it in your head is that the contribution is like this invoice entity or order entity. It's a little bit in between. And then each of the price fields in your price set are line items on there. Does that make sense? So if you created an event, for example, which had four, have you used price sets before? No, you've never used Civi before. So what I'm talking about is complete. So you can set up a price set. So Jamie's great price set. Let's say it's for events, or let's just do it for contributions. That field actually shouldn't exist. It's a bit annoying. So ignore that. That doesn't actually do anything. Right, so let's say that this is something that gets donation financial type applied. And let's say that this is text numeric quantity, unit price is one, and that one's donation. And this one's something that gets events type applied. Okay, let's just do that text as well. Price one, okay, and this one's going to be events. Okay, cool. Right, I'm now going to go to a contribution, new contribution, and here I can choose a price set, and I can say Jamie's great price set, and can you see that I've basically created two lines on my contribution now? Now, this one here and this one here will get applied differently. So the second one, because it was events, should get the events stuff. Now I need a person. Let's do that. Slightly surprising that it's not getting the VAT, because I thought I put that as a moment. But in theory, you have the two lines, and this one's getting the first accounting codes applied to it, and the second one's getting the second ones, and it'll set those in as separate financial transactions. So if I do an accounting batch, that too, let's see how it's done it. Got a little bit off piste here, but. So you can see that it's done the two lines separately. I'm not quite sure why it hasn't done the VAT. I think that's probably an oversight somewhere.
You did that on 4-7.
Ah, oh, there we go. Thank you. You're very helpful.
And you can put $5 or $10. You can change the.
So yeah, so the price sets are super flexible. So within a price set, it's like you can use various different various different types of fields. And actually, I mean, this is a little bit beyond the scope of this, but if this field can be of a different of particular type, so is it text or numeric entry, or you can have select lists or radio buttons, so that you can kind of say, okay, right, these are the options that people can select. So let's say that you have an event, a conference event, and actually people can select from, you know, how many tickets they want to buy, but also how many bus tickets they need to get, how many hotel, you know, whatever. Sorry?
Lunches.
How many lunches? Yes, that was a much better example. I'm terrible with examples. So you can kind of make those different fields, and obviously the different fields might have different VAT applied to them, but they might also go to different revenue accounts because they have different revenue accounts. So each one can be separate, like an invoice would be. That answer the question?
Yes, I think so, but I have to
think about it. If you want to chat later, that's great. Cool. Yes, go in the red hair.
So you're talking about applying the VAT as a tax add-on. Could you make it a negative tax rate to have a gift aid?
Oh, gift aid. So Civi has a gift aid module. Anyway, so download and install the gift aid module. So that would be easier. We recently updated it so that it works with line items as well. So you can set up these things and you can say, so it's the same batching process basically, which is that donation comes in, you tell the gift aid module ones which are of type donation, these ones are therefore gonna be gift aidable. Or there's a little online form that people tick we should show that at the extension showcase tomorrow, actually, that'd be good. So you know, then you can batch that. It's a separate batch, but then you've got your gift aid batch, and then you kind of go to, there is an online gift aid submission that you can use as well, but you can export this out, and then you've got like your file, and then you upload it to the gift aid portal and stuff. Yeah, cool. It actually also does something quite clever where the new one, if you set it in a certain way and say that you want 4 years. So I think the new rules is that if somebody does a gift aid declaration, it used to just be 7 years in the future or 4 years in the future or something like that. Now it's 4 years in the past plus 7 years in the future, something like that. So Civi will go back and it will update the 4 years previously ones if somebody does a submission. Yeah, hope that made sense. Cool, yes.
Got a bit confused when you said the asset account earlier on.
Yes.
Did you say the word bank?
So you can create any number of asset accounts. Let's just.
Can I hint there? Because the payment instrument indicates which bank it goes to.
Yes.
But I thought you were saying you were using asset account to allocate the bank that it's been credited to.
Very good point. Yes. It's been a little while since I've looked at this.
If you go to payment instrument, you can specify an account.
Let's go to payment processors. Oh, payment instruments, yes. Yeah. How does that all fit together?
So if you edit one of those.
Yes, it's got the financial account. So this is telling us where the cash receipt will go into. So I think that the asset class will probably be referring to the accounts receivable on the financial type. I'd have to refresh my knowledge and go back through it.
It confuses me.
But I think that is the case. Any more questions? Ah, yes.
Is it possible when you generate a batch to have, you know, just not all the separate transactions, but just to aggregate it or summarize numbers per ledger?
Yeah, so it comes out in a CSV. So the idea is that you can tot it up, you know, by doing a little pivot table or something like that. Yeah. We did discuss about having that at the bottom, but then we were kind of, that would annoy people who just want to import it type thing. Cool. Any more questions? Okay. Thank you very much for going through that for an hour. Cool.